This is elasticity, high Deborah number measurements, part 2, video 1, for polymer rheology and processing. Previously we talked about polymer conformation and polymers in solution, and so now we need to consider polymer crystallinity. So after addressing those polymers in solution, we only have part of the picture, and we really do need to address what occurs when change density is very high. When you form polymers from the melt, some solid polymers have a degree of crystallinity that could be high or low. And this has a very large effect on properties and applications. Crystalline regions consist of polymer chain segments that are closely aligned to maximize van der Waals interactions. During the cooling of the melt, these regions will nucleate. Connectivity of long macromolecular chains make crystalline regions smaller than small molecule crystallites. Also, one polymer molecule can be associated with several different crystallites. Polymers come in three main forms: amorphous, semicrystalline, and crystalline. Crystalline, truly fully crystalline polymers almost never happen. Usually we're looking at semicrystalline polymers or amorphous polymers. No polymer is completely crystalline in practice, and this is a good thing. Crystallinity makes a material stronger, but it can also make a material much more brittle. So a completely crystalline polymer would be too brittle to be used in applications in which most plastics are utilized. And these amorphous regions in a semicrystalline polymer give it toughness. And this is the ability to absorb energy and to form without fracturing. It's also the amount of energy per unit volume that a material can absorb before rupturing. So here we have a graphical representation of amorphous versus crystalline. So when you have an amorphous polymer, you have random molecular orientation in both molten and the solid phase. And some examples of this are polymethyl methacrylate, polystyrene, PVC, and ABS. Crystalline polymers have random molecular orientations in the molten phase, but densely pack into the solid phase. And you have crystalline regions interspersed between amorphous regions. And the most common crystalline polymers are polyethylene and polypropylene. As a rule, a transparent polymer is generally amorphous, whereas a polymer that is translucent or opaque displays some degree of crystallinity. So here you have an actual crystal polymer conformation. A polymer chain extends across the typical unit cell borders, and you tend to see crystallites interspersed between different regions of amorphous polymer. Here are some general effects of crystallinity. When you have semicrystalline plastics, you see a distinct and sharp melting point as opposed to a softening over a wider range. These tend to have a higher specific gravity, they tend to have a higher tensile strength and higher tensile modulus, they are less ductile, in other words less flexible, and have lower impact strength, they have higher creep resistance, they tend to be translucent, they have lower dimensional stability, higher fatigue resistance, they are more difficult to bond using adhesives and solvents than their amorphous counterparts. They tend to have higher chemical resistance and resistance to stress cracking, and they are good for bearing and wear because of the higher tensile strength. This is a periodic table of plastics, and it kind of shows you the relationship between crystallinity and whether something is and what types of polymers there are. This is just for your reference. This is an example of polyethylene, low density versus high density. Low density is more crystalline, whereas low density is less crystalline, where high density is more. LDPE has branched chains, whereas HDPE is linear. LDPE can range in crystallinity up to 50%, where HDPE can be 90%+. HDPE has a much higher melting point. It has higher tensile yield stress, much higher tensile modulus, and a higher flexural modulus, and longer elongation at break. Crystallization from the melt only occurs below the melting temperature and above the glass transition temperature. Van der Waals forces depend on the distance between the parallel chain segments, and first you get lamella that form. Here you have an ideal lamella, and here you have a more realistic one where you have amorphous chains. Growth of the crystallite is suppressed at the top and the bottom because of these amorphous folded regions. In between the crystal and the lamella, there are amorphous regions where there's no order. And a single polymer chain may be partly crystalline in the crystalline lamella and partly in the amorphous state. And chains that start in one lamella and cross the amorphous region and then join another lamella are called tie molecules, and these are very important. For melt crystallization, crystalline growth tends to happen in the direction of largest temperature gradient. So a strong gradient produces unidirectional dendritic type of growth. Isotropic and static gradients produce larger quasi-spherical aggregates rapidly. These are called spherulites, and these spherulites tend to have a size between about 1 and 10 micrometers. And they're often called Maltese crosses because of their similarity between their shape and the traditional Maltese cross when you see them in an optical microscope under cross polarizers. Nucleation is an important force in crystallinity. Crystallites will form around a nucleus or a center, and this is the reduced free energy of chains that drives this. Chain segments will diffuse from different parts of the solution and orient around a nucleating center. And crystallization favors linear chains with minimal chain entanglement for this purpose. Nucleation can be spontaneous. You have a folding over of polymer, and that creates a homogeneous nucleation center. You need really pure polymer for that. And they can form around an impurity also. This is known as heterogeneous nucleation. And this can be intentional. And when it's intentional, it's called seeding. It uses a bit of the polymer similar to the base polymer, but with a higher melting point. High nucleation and crystal growth rates are advantageous to give you a high degree of crystallization. This allows for controlled structure as well. There are many structural factors that influence crystallinity, and polymer chain length is one of them. Higher molecular weight leads to greater chain entanglement, and a greater degree of chain entanglement can prevent crystallinity. Chain branching is also another thing that can reduce crystallinity. Linear chains pack very readily, whereas branched chains prevent this packing. And so linear chains tend to be more crystalline, like linear polyethylene HDPE versus branched or LDPE polyethylene. Stereoregularity is also another consideration in a structural factor. Isotactic polymers tend to be crystalline. In other words, you have units that are repeated in a similar manner and can be crystalline. Syndiotactic also has units that are repeated but in an alternating manner and can be crystalline, but atactic polymers tend not to be crystalline at all. They tend to be amorphous because of their random order that doesn't pack as well. So here's an example. You have syndiotactic polystyrene, and this allows for regular packing of chains, whereas the atactic polystyrene is much more irregular and kind of disrupts that sort of structure. Degree of crystallinity is also affected by the presence or absence of polar groups. Sometimes you'll have carbonyls that will repel each other and prevent crystallization, but in the case of polyamides, you have hydrogen bonding that can occur between carbonyls and then the amine hydrogen. So that actually lines up and creates more crystallinity in something like a polyamid. Aromatic rings also have a tendency to stack very well. This is also known as pi stacking. And this is a very strong interaction, much like hydrogen bonding. And so here you have the phenyl rings and polyethylene terephthalate that will stack in an orderly fashion to form crystals, given the right circumstances. So, part shrinkage is a huge consideration when you're making actual parts. And when you're dealing with a crystalline part, you're affected not only by temperature, but crystalline shrinkage. As the polymer solidifies, crystalline formation and improved chain packing leads to far greater shrinkage values than that of amorphous polymers. It's up to 5 to 10 times the shrinkage value of an amorphous polymer. But only about 85% of the higher shrinkage occurs within 24 hours. You get about 98 to 99 within the first week, but without any other intervention, it can take up to 3 months for a semicrystalline polymer to completely crystallize. And this can be somewhat problematic unless you take further steps. And one way to do this is to anneal. And it's normal to anneal parts. The part is held at a maximum crystallization temperature, and this forces the equilibrium to where full shrinkage can take place within an hour. And annealing results in changes to polymer properties like molecular mobility, morphology, and, of course, physical and mechanical properties. Crystal growth, rate of nucleation and crystal growth both depend on temperature. And the rate of crystallization happens at a point directly between the TG and the TM. So for polypropylene, the TG is negative 10 to negative 20, and TM is 150 to 175. And it will slowly crystallize at room temperature unless you anneal it. For Teflon, or PTFE, the TG is negative 110, and the TM is 330. So PTFE rapidly crystallizes at room temperature. So for a polypropylene part, you really need to do some form of annealing so that you reach that equilibrium sooner rather than later, in other words, during use. You can control crystallinity in a number of ways. You can quench or rapidly cool a part to reduce crystal formation. The degree of crystal prevention depends on the relationship between TG and the surface temperature. If the TG is above the surface temperature, quenching will prevent all crystal formation. And an example of this is PET, or in other words, polyethylene terephthalate used in pop bottles. That's why you get nice, clear pop bottles, even though this is a crystalline polymer. If TG is equal to or below the surface temperature, quenching will only delay crystallization. It will continue to happen during use, which can be detrimental. You can also orient or draw a polymer to induce directional crystallization below the TM. This is called cold drawing. Your crystalline filaments, fibers, or sheets, this is often advantageous in those applications. And crystallization is oriented in the direction of stretching, and this is used to produce high-strength fibers and films. Orientation and drawing can produce increased tensile strength. It can also reduce flexibility or compliance with the resulting material. The molecules in the crystallites are stretched out during crystallization, and these time molecules I mentioned before also become stretched out. It's important in these amorphous regions for these time molecules to have some form of springiness related. So if there's a deformation that's produced by a load, it is actually the response to these amorphous tie chains in between the lamella. Here you have a semicrystalline polymer that has random crystalline domains, and here you've reached this point on the stress-strain curve, where you've kind of got still these tie chains that are not oriented. If you continue to draw them, you start to get this oriented morphology, where these particular tie chains are stretched out. And that's where you tend to get the point right before fracture, so like the ultimate strength. So you're actually seeing this drawing procedure here is what you're actually showing is the stretching out of these chains. So for a network of springs, where tie chains act like springs, the shear modulus is shown here, where N sub S is the spring density, KB is the Boltzmann constant, T is the temperature. This can also be written in terms of molecular weight of polymer springs, as shown here, where CP is the polymer concentration, M sub S is the molecular weight of the polymer spring, and N sub A is Avogadro's number. So one example of this is a 20% PVA hydrogel, and this has a Poisson's ratio of 0.3. This results in an M sub S of 110, and what this means is there's an average of 2 to 3 monomer units between crystallites. This indicates a very high degree of organization and high degree of crystallinity in the system, and this results in a very high modulus. And I've shown a PVA hydrogel here. Now, I've said before that semicrystalline polymers are translucent and opaque, but this is a clear hydrogel. So how is that? How does that happen? The size of the crystallite makes a difference in the appearance as well. Big crystallites will scatter light, making the material appear opaque or translucent, and you get reflection, in that case, of the visible light. Small crystallites will allow light to pass through the material and make the material appear clear. So you can have a semicrystalline polymer that appears clear and still have some degree of crystallinity if the size of the crystallites is small. Thus concludes Elasticity Part 2. Thank you.